One of the things about healthcare providers is that we love to share stories. We want to share our successes, our challenges, but most importantly, we want to debrief, share those hard moments so we can lighten our burdens. Tonight, I'd like to share a story with you. It's about a normal evening. A wife and a husband are wrapping up the day, watching some TV. He feels ill and thinks he'll go upstairs. His wife in the kitchen hears a loud clatter and then a bang, and she runs to the foyer. She discovers him on the floor. She yells at him, tries to shake him. Nothing works. But she knows she needs help, so what does she do? She calls 911. The operator says, EMS is on the way. Will you start CPR? After a moment of stressed discussion and confusion, she says, no, I have to put away the dogs. I have to put away the dogs. 5 to 6 minutes later, EMS shows up and starts CPR. For that 5 or 6 minutes, his heart's not beating, and blood's not going to his brain or anywhere else. Luckily, we have good news. This story has a happy ending. He still made it, but not all of these stories end so well. In my role as an ER and EMS physician, I see these events in people's homes, in the public, and even in the hospital. And part of my research work, I've tried to better understand what happens in these moments. And as I've debriefed these events, the same theme kept coming back. I wish I did more. In the moment where our actions could change the outcome, we come up short. And these stories hit us all. We wish we could have gotten there sooner. I wish I gave this medication faster. I wish I drove a little faster. Now, thinking back to my story, I was the emergency doctor talking to her. She wished she did more. And then she asked me, isn't there anything else you can do? Now, my interpretation of this was a little different. Isn't there anything else you can do to stop this tide of grief I see coming my way? And the whole time, your soul is screaming, I wish, I wish, I wish. We are scared, and we carry this regret with us together. We can all relate to this I wish moment, the moment where we wish we would have acted, and we play it back in our minds. These are normal, everyday things. Standing up to a bully, helping your neighbor cross the street, speaking out against obvious racism or sexism. In our research, we look at this question in detail for cardiac arrest and CPR. Now, cardiac arrest is an electronic dysfunction in the heart that stops it from beating properly. 350,000 people per year have a cardiac arrest event, and only 10% survive. Now, here's the hard fact. Of all these people who have cardiac arrest events, only 1/3 receive a treatment which can improve their outcome by threefold. I know you're tracking with me. It's bystander CPR. In this moment, your hands are their heart. Unfortunately, time doesn't stand still. Every second that passes is no blood to the heart, to the brain, leading to devastation. Now, when we debrief these events, what we find is a similar theme, and much of it is associated with fear. Fear of the unknown, fear of hurting someone, fear of doing the wrong thing, fear of what will happen, fear of danger to ourselves. Pretty powerful. So how do we change this story so we act? In the case of CPR, we may think it's how we act, but that's only one part of the story. So much of it is our intention to act. Now, the exciting thing is we have found that you can increase your intention to act. And there's specific factors that you can focus on. Now, there are certain things that you can't change or just really, really hard to change. Age, gender, education, religion, socioeconomic status. But the things we can change, those are our big levers. So some of our big levers are these: our attitudes towards CPR, our perceived norms concerning CPR, our self-efficacy towards CPR, or our belief that we can perform the behavior. So let's start with the attitudes. Our attitudes towards CPR is really, do we believe it'll work? And in truth, most physicians for a really long time didn't believe it. And this wasn't long ago. This was like the 80s and 90s. If someone had a cardiac arrest event, we assumed that they were good as dead. Now that's, of course, unless you're watching Grey's Anatomy where everyone survives. Now, one of my friends was in a company in the 80s when the people weren't really learning CPR. Her manager made their focus to teach their whole team how to do CPR. That training, that thoughtful boss, saved my friend's life. She was young, she was in her 30s, and right there in the office had a cardiac arrest event. In that moment, her friends in the office did something truly miraculous. They took charge, they acted, they believed in what they could do, and they performed CPR for 20 minutes. Their hands were her heart, and guess what? Her heart was strong. She made it. And each of those people's lives changed due to their change in attitude. Another one of our big levers is our perceived norms about performing CPR. So what does society expect me to do? How will I be judged? These days, much of our perceived norms are colored by Twitter, Instagram, or some great marketing agent. But so much of this idea of what should be the norm, a lot of that starts at home. So I was on a trip with my family, and my 8-year-old son was walking with me in the airport. As we were walking by an escalator, an older woman tumbles down the escalator, landing on her face, but the escalator kept moving. I immediately pushed him over to my wife, and I went over to help. What was significant on that day for me wasn't the event. It was talking and, well, debriefing with my son. We chatted and so many feelings came up. Fear, dread, confusion, fear for me, but also recognition that even though he was afraid for me, I was supposed to help. Now there's my aha moment. At that moment, together, we set a new normal about what our role is as a father and son. We help. And I'm very proud of that Boy Scout who's 11 years old now and is accepting responsibility and refusing to be passive. When he acts, something great will happen. Well, let's talk about our final lever, our personal self-efficacy towards CPR. This is our individual belief in our capacity to execute a behavior. In this case, CPR. It's our confidence in our abilities. Do you believe you have the capacity to make it happen? Now, I'm a lifelong volunteer for the American Heart Association. I'm a guideline writer, and most importantly, I'm a CPR trainer. Every year, I go to the Heart Walk, and not only do I walk in support, but to teach CPR. On those sunny summer days, we end up teaching hundreds of people to save a life. One person taught me a valuable lesson. Your capacity is set by what you believe you can achieve. I had just finished teaching another couple to perform CPR, and a man walked up to me and asked to learn CPR. Now, normally, I'm convincing people. I'm like, come on over here, let me teach you CPR. And I would start going into my standard intro with him. Let's get down here together, let's work on this mannequin, let's put our hands together. And I stopped because I realized he had only one arm. He stopped me in my tracks. I didn't know if he could do the compressions, if he could push deep enough or hard enough. But what got me was that he was so interested. No, he was convinced he could do it. He knew in his heart of hearts that this is something he could do. And he proved me wrong. He was so motivated. And he told me about this a little later. His older mother is living with him now, and he wanted to be ready. He knew. His self-efficacy, his belief made it possible, not my training. Let's put this all together. So we have our three cores: attitudes towards CPR, our perceived norms, and our self-efficacy, or our belief in our capacity to perform. In the end, these three allow us to change the script. And we can work on each of these individually, right? But in the end, we can build a new character for ourselves in our own stories. And I love the idea of building a story. It's like the knight repeating their pledges of chivalry to be able to face the fears of battle. He wrote a story. I think we can say the same thing for the modern day hero, the firefighter, who when needed will run into a burning building for us. This is what I talk about with my boys all the time. Be who you want to be and advocate for the world around you, because we can do big things when we act. Now, certainly this is true for cardiac arrest. We can save a life. But what if I apply this to other parts of my life? Well, we can make a sentence out of this. People who are more engaged and willing to act to fill in the blank here. What do you want? Imagine a world where the societal norm is that we act when something is wrong. When we see a bully, when we see injustice, we act. I want to leave you with one thought. Write your own story. Let's all ask ourselves, who are we and what do we want to be? Thank you.